Humans have been taking advantage of radioactivity for more than a century now, in countless ways, both big and small, good and bad, smart and less smart. And so, over time, we've had to deal with ever-increasing amounts of radioactive waste, in lots of different forms. Like, some of the biggest challenges in working out how to use radiation effectively are really about how to store that material safely once it's served its purpose. And some of the answers to that particular problem are a lot weirder than you'd think. First, a quick recap of what radioactivity even is. There are all kinds of atoms out there, and some are more stable than others. And those unstable ones are prone to just spontaneously breaking down into some more stable kinds of atoms, which also releases a bunch of energy from that atom. Some types of radiation release enough energy that it can knock electrons off atoms of other things, which is called ionizing radiation. And too much of that can damage your DNA, leading to harmful mutations and even cancers. We're exposed to radiation all the time, at low doses in everyday life. Phones don't emit the harmful kind, but weirdly, bananas do, just in minuscule, totally safe amounts. It's really only when we're exposed to human-made, artificially high levels of ionizing radiation that things get dangerous. Because these radioactive substances are constantly breaking down and decaying, that means that with enough time, a dangerous radioactive thing will release enough energy that it becomes a not dangerous, not radioactive thing. That amount of time can be measured in a half-life, which is how long it takes a sample of that type of material to break down by half. Different radioactive sources can remain dangerous for different lengths of time, from a few microseconds to millions of years. And the length of that half-life is just one of the crucial factors in figuring out just what to do with your radioactive stuff when you're done with it. When we talk about radioactive waste, there's usually one thing that comes to mind: power plants. How nuclear power plants generate their juice is complicated, and we don't have time to get into all the details. But the gist is that they use rods of a radioactive material and immerse them in water. The decay of all those atoms releases energy in the form of heat. A typical nuclear power plant is set up to harness that heat by keeping the fuel rods underwater, using the steam to run a generator, and boom. Electricity. But these nuclear fuel rods only last for a few years before they lose their oomph, and they need to get swapped out for fresh ones, which means you end up with radioactive rods that you need to store somewhere. The storage of spent fuel for the reactors actually happens in several stages, and the first stage looks like what you do with the fuel rods when you're using them. Once they're past their prime, the fuel rods are put in a pool of water at the plant. These pools are usually about 40 feet deep and lined with steel. Typically, they'll spend around 5 years in these waterbeds before the next stage. But even though the rods aren't radioactive enough to be used as fuel, they're still, you know, highly radioactive. So the pool is also filled with materials like boron that are good at absorbing radiation from the rods. After a rod has decayed enough, it's moved to what's called dry cask storage. Essentially, these are just big metal cylinders, but those are less fun to talk about. So let's stick to the pools. These pools are actually pretty safe, because along with that boron, the water itself is surprisingly good at blocking radioactivity. It's been claimed that swimming at the top of a spent fuel pool may not be especially dangerous. Since the fuel rods are at the very bottom, most of the radiation is shielded and can't reach the surface, meaning that you won't get hit by much of it hanging out at the surface level. But please don't try this at home. Now, nuclear pools are fine for the short term, but there have been plenty of debates over the years about how to store nuclear waste for the super long term. Some substances will remain radioactive for thousands or even millions of years, so even if you store them in a cave somewhere, it might not stay there. Even if the cave is dry and far from groundwater now, maybe in a million years that won't be the case, and you'll have toxic waste mixing with the water that people drink. Or, you know, those, like, post-human robot cyborg alien people? I don't know, it's hard to predict the future. But anyways, the point is that you need a way to make that waste harder to leak into the groundwater or get tampered with. So one invention that people use today to help keep the waste safe for extreme times is to turn the waste into glass in a process called vitrification. Since the 1990s, the US military has used this process to treat some of its vintage nuclear waste. They went back and processed their nuclear waste from weapons production in World War II and the Cold War. War and managed to vitrify that too. And in 2026, vitrification is set to begin at one of the US's largest nuclear waste facilities, a site in Washington state that dates back to the Manhattan Project. So how do you turn waste into glass? Well, it's a simple recipe. You just dry out your liquid radioactive waste into a powder and add that powder to molten glass in a smelter with just a pinch of glass-forming additives for seasoning. Then pour the molten glass into a container and let it cool. Once the glass has solidified, weld the container shut and put it in the cave for 2 to 3 eternities. And voila, one nuclear glass cake. The idea is that the formerly liquid waste is now safely mixed in with the glass in solid form, meaning it's unable to leak into its surroundings, even over geological timescales. Or at least that's the hope, because it's a little bit impossible to know for sure if the glass will remain stable for that long without testing it for a long time. In fact, one UK university has been studying this process in a decades-long experiment, and the intention is to let it run for 500 more years. So we'll report back once we see the results, as long as it's still people on Earth and not the robo-cyborgs. But we use radiation in plenty of other places besides power plants or weapons. It's also vital in medical settings, from diagnostics to treatments. Unlike in power plants, the radioactive materials used in hospitals tend not to have very long half-lives. For instance, technetium is used as a tracer for doctors to visualize how well certain organs are functioning, based on how much of it they absorb. Its half-life is about 6 hours, which is why it's not such a big deal to go putting it in patients. And objects contaminated with technetium can usually be safely disposed of as normal medical waste. But if medical radioactive waste has a longer half-life, say a few weeks, it needs to be stored for longer. One study recommended storing it in a safe storage container, like a lead-lined room, for about 10 half-lives, or until about 0.1% of the radioactivity is still around. But some medically important radioactive stuff stays around for a lot longer. Cobalt-60, which is used to sterilize medical equipment and to treat cancer, has a half-life of 5 years. So while you'd think that means we shouldn't just store it in our hospitals when we're done with it, that's still exactly what we're doing. See, while there are strict guidelines for handling medical radioactive waste, they can be a bit inconsistent. But that only matters if you're handling that waste, and if you're just leaving it alone in a big empty room, no handling, no problem. That may sound bad, but it's actually pretty safe. The rooms are usually lined to hold the radiation in, so it would only be a problem if you hung out inside the room for a while. So just make sure you don't get lost while you're looking for the bathroom. Now, researching all these storage methods needs funding, and so do we. So here's a quick ad. Thanks to Incogni for supporting this SciShow video. Incogni is a tool to prevent spam, identity theft, and personal data breaches. Their goal is to combat the data brokers that collect and sell your personal information, like social security numbers, or emails, or other login credentials. Using AI, scammers can mimic your friends and family's voices to trick you into sending them money. And they know what your loved ones sound like because your voice data is all over the place online. But Incogni makes it harder to get your personal data, so you're less likely to become a victim of those kinds of scams. You can get that protection using the code SciShow at incogni.com/SciShow or clicking the link in the description. That link will also give you 60% off an annual Incogni plan. As part of that plan, Incogni will contact more than 230 data brokers on your behalf to request that they remove your personal data. And they'll keep your data off the market with repeated removals. But you don't have to be intimidated by a long-term annual commitment because they offer a 30-day money-back guarantee. If you find that you aren't happy with their service, Incogni will give you a full refund. Incogni helps you stay safe on the internet so you can keep finding cool stuff like this video. You might have noticed that a lot of the items in this list basically boil down to leave the waste somewhere and wait for it to decay. And that's fine if it's done in a controlled way. But sometimes the waste gets left around in a not-so-controlled way. Which is how you get stories of radioactive waste just being dumped into random bodies of water with pretty devastating consequences. It's happened in several countries over the decades, including our own. See, the processes used to mine uranium can leave behind solid radioactive waste, called tailings, and liquid radioactive waste, called raffinates. And certain kinds of uranium mining projects leave the waste in specially designed ponds, called impoundments, on the side of the mine. Now, this isn't quite as irresponsible as it sounds. As long as the site is isolated, observed, and protected, the harm can be reduced. And like we said before, water is a good radiation blocker. Plus, when uranium decays into radium, that radium will decay into a gas called radon. So that means that most of the radioactive waste will just float off. Of course, if you're not convinced by how safe that all sounds, well, you kinda shouldn't be, because the problem with both these types of waste is that they don't always stay where you put them. Raffinates can seep into groundwater, and the dust from the tailings can be carried by wind, which is as bad as it sounds. Unfortunately, some Navajo communities have been severely impacted by improperly cleaned up former uranium mines. Researchers have speculated that a bump in cancer rates in these communities could be linked to the nearby mines. One paper looking at who had high levels of uranium found that 27% of Navajo study participants had high levels of uranium in their bodies, compared to just 5% in the general US population. The cleanup of the mines and the fight for justice are still ongoing. So let that be a lesson to you. When it comes to radioactive waste, the answer is not to just set it and forget it. Our last unconventional storage method isn't about where radioactive sources are stored, but where beams of radiation are dumped. We're talking about the Large Hadron Collider, the gigantic underground particle physics experiment headquartered in Switzerland. The scientists in this facility do experiments using beams of energy that are like unfathomably powerful. And they use these beams to accelerate subatomic particles to just barely under the speed of light. Particles are emitted in every radioactive process, like uranium decaying into radium. But the particles in the LHC can have tens of millions of times more energy than the particles from those other normal processes. So while the particles of the LHC aren't the same as the normal kinds of radioactive sources that we've been talking about, they're still a form of radiation, and they're extremely dangerous. A single beam of LHC particles can together have more energy than an intercity train moving at max speed. That's dangerous even before you factor in the radioactivity. So where do the scientists at the LHC send that radiation after it's done being used for the experiments? Well, they use cylindrical slabs hooked up to the main accelerator ring in a process called beam dumping. These slabs function as sort of off-ramps where the beam traffic can be redirected after it's done being used. The beam dumps are made of graphite, wrapped in stainless steel, and surrounded by layers of concrete and iron shielding blocks to further prevent radiation leakage. And yeah, the slabs become highly radioactive after heavy use. Being hit by so much radioactive energy will kind of do that. During a long shutdown a few years ago, the LHC conducted a sort of autopsy of some beam dumps and found significant radiation coming from them. So they had to dispose of those graphite blocks the same way nuclear power plant materials are. Oh, and besides radiation concerns, the blocks need to withstand immense heat fluxes. The LHC beams can heat them up by as much as 1500 degrees Celsius in as little as 100 microseconds. That autopsy found significant cracks in parts of the beam dumps, underscoring just how powerful these particle beams can be. So these beam dumps are one of the most crucial and under-talked about parts of the LHC. Figuring out exactly how and where to store the world's radioactive waste is a huge challenge, whether that's for the short term, like in hospitals, or for the extremely long term. Radiation is scary to think about, and it's just plain hard to plan for something tens of thousands or even millions of years from now. Which is why we need to store it all safely, if only to protect the robo-cyborgs of the future.